Good evening, I'm Jeff Koinange, and this is Jeff Koinange Live. Now, the Jubilee government has been in power now for about 10 months, and already so many challenges in such a short time. Alleged scandals, everything from the Tasia housing project to the standard gauge railway. Also, policemen storming mosques. What is that about? On the other side, is it a selection or an election? We're talking ODM and so much more in between. We have two sober minds who are going to try and give us some answers. We're asking the question, is this the Kenya we want? You know what time it is. It is time to ask the hard questions. It is time for Jeff Koinange Live. And a very warm welcome to all our viewers from around the country. This is Jeff Koinange live at the poolside of the Intercontinental Hotel. If you want to get involved in this program, my Twitter handle is at Koinange Jeff. Let's get busy asking my two guests on the far right. You're going to need a paper and pen. You're going to need a dictionary, even a thesaurus. Better yet, go straight to Wikipedia. Because when PLO comes on the bench, you know he's waxing lyrical. Right next to him, former Member of Parliament for Lagdera, former Deputy Speaker of the 10th Parliament. He holds nothing back. He calls it like he sees it. Farah Marlin, gentlemen, thanks so much for coming. These are sober times. You think 10 months into this government, we would be coasting. There was a time we were considered the most optimistic people on the planet. Well, Shimiwa, let me come to you first. This storming of the mosque the other day, when you see police going in, allegedly they had information about arms and other stuff, and then arresting everyone arbitrarily during prayers. When they end up in court, you see little kids inside the courtroom behind bars. What does this say about us?
Well, everybody's shocked. I am shocked like everybody else. But I don't think this is a pure accident. It's an overreaction, or it's not any of that. In my opinion, this is by design. In my opinion, the idea is to create a proliferation of so-called extremist, fanatic, terrorist-linked Muslims in the country.
PLO, this doesn't augur well. It doesn't endear the police to the locals.
Without doubt, Jeff, one of the things that I think is very critical in this country is that we must deal with security differently. The security organs must remember that terrorism will not be eliminated if we feed it in the manner that we are doing. And I don't believe that you storm places of worship. I believe that if we have the NSIS, if we have the CID, if we have the police, we should obtain necessary intelligence to nip this kind of thing in the bud, because the terrorist wants you to behave exactly the way our police behave, because it then gives them the justification for saying that we are being condemned without reason and justification. And I hope that my good friend Ole Lenku and the men and women who serve under him will compare notes with regimes that have dealt with these situations before and deal with it in a different manner.
Yeah.
When I hear it being said that you want to close the mosques, that would be the most absurd thing that has ever happened anywhere in the world, because the terrorist wants you to shut down. But those little children ought to be dealt with differently. I can't agree with Farah Marlin more that we need to do things differently.
Moshimua, this past weekend there was a what you call an extreme credible threat, if you will. I mean, they were saying avoid malls, avoid this, avoid that. There was even a rumor that British Airways had canceled their flights into Kenya. I mean, it was that heightened. Have we become that kind of a society? Or do we have the right intel, I guess, is the better question to ask?
No, absolutely not. When you come out there and say that we have the intel, avoid the malls, avoid these public places, because there's going to be a terrorist strike, It means you have information that is credible, you have information that is firm and factual, then why don't you deal with it? Why don't you stop these people before they do what you tell everybody that they're going to do? So the issue is maybe the Western countries, in a sense, do that, see the lapses in our own intelligence gathering and the way our own security machinery is working, and maybe after they are frustrated, in the manner that they are frustrated, then they will tell their own nationals to avoid some of these places. But that does not excuse the Kenyan security machinery.
Yeah.
The Kenyan security machinery, which is supposed to be working in tandem with other security machineries from the developed world, the FBI, the CIA, the MI5, the MI6, should be able to nip these things in the bud. For example, in the case of the mosque, they claim that the arms was being taken in there, radicalism was ongoing there. The intelligence officers who are Muslims, who have been sitting in that mosque, who invariably, if those things were happening, know exactly what was happening. Why not go and pick the guys who are radicalizing the youth? Why go and stop the mosque and do what they have done?
Yeah.
Why wait for them on the main roads on the Bamburi Road, the main Nyali Bamburi Road, and shoot them extrajudicially? All these sheikhs were killed. All these young men and middle-aged men who are being killed, in our opinion, by the security machinery.
PLO,
and you Jeff, said... It's very easy for Malim and I to be dismissed by some individual. These are armchair analysts. Mm-hmm. Looking at these things from a theoretical perspective. But we are Kenyans, and what we are saying is that if you want to deal with terrorism, you don't make us stop living. In fact, that is what the terrorist wants. And I can't agree with Mali Moore when he says you deal with the puppeteer, not the puppet. And if you have the right intelligence, you can identify these individuals. I remember as a young man, we were told that we had one of the best intelligence resources in this part of the world.
Yeah.
And I still believe we do. I still believe we can deploy these resources. And I still believe that if we deployed them properly, then we can nip this in the bud. But what I saw last week, crying wolf, and that it turns out that these things were merely things that were being thrown as red herrings, is not a good thing for this country.
And you mentioned something earlier on, PLO, about getting the puppeteer. You think there's some Al-Shabaab guy in some village in Somalia somewhere who makes this call and sees our reaction and laughs and says, you see that? We can control this country from where we are.
Oh, yeah. Say, this country is in a panic mode. We can control them the way we want, and we will tell them not to go there to their malls, not to go to their schools, and a terrorist loves that. So what I would want to hear from those who are in charge of security is to give us confidence, to tell us that we must continue to live our lives, that they are in control, and we ought to feel and see that they are actually in control, and we will help them because security is a shared responsibility. We are citizens of this country. We also owe it to our country to report to them when we see that there is a security threat. But if they continue telling us, we are going to shut this down, we are going to shut this down, then we begin to ask ourselves, what about the massive resources that we continue to contribute to and that are deployed for this very purpose?
Absolutely. Yeah. Good point, gentlemen. And we are asking the question, is this the Kenya we want? And we must talk about it. If we don't talk about it, who will? If not now, then who will do it? My hashtag on Twitter is JKL. Keep the questions, comments, thoughts coming through as we switch gears. Gentlemen, the other story that's dominated the headlines the last few weeks, and it's a story that has great implications down the line, but the implementation, the bad blood, the I guess the way it's just being, it's rolling out, literally is just ugly. Of course, we're talking about the standard gauge railway. And each and every day, we're hearing people coming out and saying, it's the biggest scandal since Goldenberg and Anglo Leasing combined. There are brokers out there, or MPs acting as brokers for very large cartels who nobody wants to mention or nobody cares to mention. Come on, man. When are we going to ever call a spade a spade?
Jeff, the president and his deputy looked Kenyan straight in the face and told them, this is the gamblings of brokers. Ordinarily, when there's a brokerage, when there's a middle person between a buyer and a seller, there's a bit of a padding for the middle, there's a commission for the middle person. What we expected the president and his deputy to tell us is that, look, allowing these brokers to come into this business, it will cost us 3 point something billion shillings. billion US dollars. But because we have cut them out, we have to save this money, and every coin has to be saved for the sake of Kenyans. We have brought this one down to $2 billion. You see what I mean?
Yes.
You can't tell us that they were brokers, and then you tell us a price that is by far, way above any brokerage ever seen in this part of the world. It is not as big as Goldenberg and Anglo-Leeson put together. It's bigger than anything that has ever happened in this country put together. In terms of these big things, Kendrin, Anglo-Leeson, Goldenberg, put all that together. We're going to be paying this for the rest of our lives, and our children will pay for this for ages to come. Kendrin was in the 70s.
Yeah.
We're still paying for it.
So
we're paying for a fertilizer factory that never was there.
40 years ago.
40 years ago. Nobody has gone to jail. The money has gone into the pockets of people, and quite a bit of it has also gone into the pockets of the people who worked out the funding and the financing and the rest of it. But at the end of the day, it was guaranteed by the Kenya government, or rather it was a loan to be paid by the Kenya government.
Mm-hmm.
And we're still paying it.
The same with Standard Gauge Railway.
The Standard Gauge Railway, we will pay for this for ages to come. We'll pay for it until me and you are gone, no longer there. And our children will probably be in their 40s and their 50s. Those ones who are yet to be born, some of them today.
PLO, what I found a little strange last week is the president coming out in a press conference, you know, surrounded by his cabinet secretaries, and he said, this whole deal was above board. This thing is going ahead. Pende msipende. Do what you want. It's going ahead. But there's still rumblings.
You know, Jeff, to our credit, myself, John Githongo, and Tom Boyer wrote a letter to the president, and it was a very sober letter. We were telling our president, Your Excellency, the rail project is a good thing. Kenya needs it. East Africa needs it. But within the ranks of your own administration, we hear people saying that he's not above board. Do that which is good and right. Come out. Make it all in the open. When I heard my president speak the following day, my president, in so many words, said, you are busybodies. You have no business telling us what you are telling us. We are going on irrespective. And I am telling my president today that we are not busybodies. We love this country. We respect his administration. We are saying, go on with the project, but go on with a project that every Kenyan in every village and in every hamlet in this country knows and believes that money has been spent well, because this generation and generations yet to be born will pay for it. That is all we are saying.
Absolutely.
Nothing more.
And look at your colleagues. Look at your colleagues in Parliament. Now the Speaker is gagging his colleagues from talking about it.
How do you say something is above board when there is no competitive tender for that?
Hmm.
When it's you want to shroud it in a government-to-government, G2G, so that it does not become subject to scrutiny. Why don't you put it as an open tender, where you go through these things and invite people from all over the world, an international tender, to apply for this, get the best out of it, and then go on a G2G on the financing itself?
Absolutely.
Go on a G, because we're not getting free money from China.
No.
Jeff.
No.
We're not getting free money from China. We don't even know who in China is also having his cut in that.
Absolutely.
In the absence of that, Kenyans, you know, I don't miss words. Kenyans will say, let the president and his deputy tell us where this money is going. The buck stops with them.
Mm-hmm.
We have a reason to believe, and it's not a reason to believe, we're sure, 100% sure some people are eating in the process.
Absolutely.
The money is being siphoned away. This is not their money. It doesn't belong to them. Kenya doesn't belong to
them. And the other thing we're saying, PLO, about
I'm not possibly as blatant as Farah is. I sometimes tend to be a little bit more charitable to President Kenyatta and his administration by saying, the president, I give you the benefit of doubt, but we are asking valid questions, and it behooves you to answer those valid questions, because we are the guarantors of your presidency, and we want you to succeed.
But every time, and we keep talking, we've talked about this several times, it's the people around this man, the people around him are letting him down.
Look.
Is it,
Jeff,
too late for excuses?
Jeff, I don't buy that nonsense.
I also don't buy it.
I don't buy that nonsense. Mm. This business of trying to look somebody else to blame on these things, who advises the president. Mm. We had it with Kenyatta, the first Kenyatta. We had it with Moi. We had it with Kibaki. We can't have this thing going on forever. The issue is, he takes the responsibility for his government. If something goes wrong, he should be the one who should go on the moral high ground and say, gentlemen, I am sorry, something has gone bad. I'm taking an exit out of this place. Mm. I'm walking out. I'm resigning. Are you getting my point?
Yeah, yeah.
Not coming to us and telling us as if we're a small school children, 40 million Kenyans, mupende musipende. Even Moi, at the height of his so-called dictatorship,
yes.
Which today, by the way, many of us are seeing it as a benevolent dictatorship.
People actually wish.
We are wishing for Moi, let me be very honest with you.
I was not in Kanu.
I was never in Kanu. I've never been in Kanu myself. But, you know, Moi will never go out there and tell Kenyans mupende msipende. Mm. Moi will never go to Kenyans and tell them, I am going to be here for the 10 years to come, and my deputy is going to be here for the next 10 years. You people are making a lot of noise. Think about after 20 years.
So what is it? What is it about these two who we had so much hope in?
No. The fact of the matter is that we have a system, we have a country here. Kenyans are not going to accept this. And Jeff, you know the saddest part of it? Mm. We don't even have a credible opposition.
Correct.
We don't have an opposition.
Yeah.
Opposition which I belong to myself.
Yes. Your ODM
double. My ODM is as good as debt.
In fact, I want to talk about that after the break. That's a good point.
Should we write it some beat?
I'm serious.
It's as good as debt.
I was shocked to see the leadership, the top leadership of ODM defending this.
This railway project.
Exactly.
So you wonder.
That reminds me of our parliament. I was in parliament for all these years. And members of parliament would be at one another's throat until an issue comes in that is to their own benefit. For example, hiking their own allowances or hiking their own salaries.
Salary.
And then suddenly there is a real camaraderie.
Yeah, there's unity.
And unity, 100% unity. Now, are we having a unity of eating between the opposition and the government?
On that note, my friend, I think we're going to take a break. Plenty more to talk about. Oh, my, womai. It's getting pretty hot on the bench and we are just warming up. Former Deputy Speaker Farah Maalim and former anti-corruption czar PLO Lumumba on the bench talking issues. At the end of the day, is this the Kenya we want? If not, maybe, just maybe, we can do something about it. Chef Kunenga live from the poolside of the Intercontinental Hotel takes his first break. Coming up, plenty more to come. Stay with us. We're back in a moment. Welcome back to Jeff Kunenga live from the poolside of the Intercontinental Hotel. And you know, when PLO, Lumumba and Farah Maalim get together on this bench, it's going to be smoking. In fact, Amon Biwat is asking, where's your fire extinguisher? I got it right here, bro. And I know it's getting pretty warm on this bench. We're going to get to it. Before the break, Farah Maalim said something really, really, well, it depends on who you ask. He says, ODM is?
As good as dead for now.
And why do you say that?
Because ODM was a movement. A movement in the same fashion as ANC, for example. And you don't decide and determine the leadership of a movement. You see what I mean? You allow it. You remember Thabo Mbeki was the president. He tried to emasculate the will of the mainstream ANC when the mainstream ANC were fascinated by somebody who has hardly gone to school, Zuma. But who, in the eyes of the South African people, basically is a demonstration of everything that they are proud of. He fought for change. He was a common man's person. And they went there, sucked. ANC sucked Thabo Mbeki, the president.
Yeah. The top intellectual, the most brilliant person.
The most brilliant person who was the president and brought Zuma in. And in that interim period, there was an acting president. You know that?
Yes.
There was an acting president.
Mokhlante, yes.
Yes, Mokhlante. Now, when the party leader sits out there and decides for people how ODM is going to be in the future and is not able to, in a sense, allow for transition and say that I'm handing over this to the new cadre of party leadership, people who have been there throughout, and saying that, okay, here you go. There are people who struggled for change in this country from the 90s. They fought for change from the 90s. And are still there in the party. Nobody has consulted them.
Yeah.
One person sits somewhere and decides who is going to hold what position in the party itself.
But Farah,
again to be seen to be hanging on to it, most likely seeking again a fourth time to make a shot at it.
Mm.
The institution is not the individual. The other way around, the person must be part of the institution.
PLO, you were saying?
I was saying that I'm not a member of ODM. I've never been. But there is a sense in which I blame the leadership. That when you have treated your leader for too long as if he was a demigod, he begins to believe that he's a demigod. He begins to think that he's the equivalent of the Roman Catholic Pope. And when he speaks ex cathedra, you've got to obey him. And I think there is a sense in which ODM has treated their leader in that manner. And they are beginning to resist now, rather late in the day. But because I'm not their member, I can only watch from afar and say, lo and behold, the Titanic is sinking.
I am there.
And people are bailing. They're bailing.
They're taking there. Their life.
You're ODM.
I am ODM.
Yes.
But the ship, the ship is sinking.
You say that yourself.
That's a reality that you cannot avoid to take note of.
But PLO, what is the alternative? All these people who are either opting out or defecting, where are they going? What's there for them? Do they go to the TNAs and the URPs and the wipers?
No, Jeff. My own view is that what Kenya needs is a new sense of social consciousness. I said that Kenya needs political hygiene. The problem that we have had in this country is the same individuals. If you look at the individuals who have been moving from party to party as if there were no boundaries. And I said at one time, and I repeated ad nauseum, that the forest has remained the same. The monkeys keep on changing. The same monkeys with the same habits. Yeah. What we need is a new crop of men and women who think differently. Kenyans must morally rearm. And it is incumbent upon us, upon the new generation, who can come forth and say, we are Kenyans. We are not Kikuyus, not Luos, not Kambas, not Luhyas. We celebrate our tribes for their beauty, but we build a nation that is founded on ideology and principles about health, about agriculture, about education, so that we are good citizens of East Africa.
Mheshimiwa, is there time for that between now and 2017, which literally seems around the corner?
The sad part of it is that, like I told you, without mincing words about it, ODM is sinking. We just hope there's some kind of a salvation. But the sad part of it is that we don't even have an option. There's no alternative. You look at Jubilee, and it's all about how the banquet can be shared out. It's like we can take 70% of all that is for Kenya between two communities. But it's one community that has taken a little bit more than 50%. It should be 50-50. That's essentially how it is. So this is another cartel. It's a syndicate. It's a mafia, in a sense, when you look at it. Let me be honest with you and put it very candidly. Because even the mafias have a problem sometimes in sharing the loot.
Yeah, that's why they engage in street battles.
And they engage in street battles.
Yes.
But so something has to be done. Yeah. This country is worse off today than it was in 1991. Worse off than it was in 1992 in terms of the hope for the future. At that time, we knew where the problem was. We were seeking a space, political space. We were seeking the kind of liberties. We were seeking an open market. And there was that kind of so-called totalitarian, in quotes. Mm. I no longer subscribe to that. I think it was even much more benevolent in terms of the social justice.
Yeah.
But today, what do you think of? We have people in their 30s, people in their 40s doing all sorts of awful things to the country.
I'm not as pessimistic as Farah is. Sure. I hold the view that there are a number of things that we are doing right. I hold the view that this country has great potential. I hold the view that there are certain fundamental things that are not being done right. And my appeal to the regime that is in power now is that they have an opportunity to lead this country on a proper political, economic, and social trajectory. But they ought to listen. When I see this administration wanting to reduce the space for the civil society, when I see this regime shooting from the hip, then I'm getting worried. But I will say that this country is still the greatest country in East Africa, that this country has the potential, but what we must do is to run away from what Farah is saying. Mm. The assumption that the Jubilee government is about Kalenjins and Kikuyus must stop. We are more than 42 communities, and each one of them must have a seat at the national dinner table so that they feel that they are part of this. If they are excluded, where do they go? They are not Ugandans, absolutely. They are not Kenyans, they are not Tanzanians, they are Kenyans.
Moses Koech has said, at least there is an ODM member who doesn't bury his head in the sand like the rest. ODM needs to reinvent itself. Mm. Gentlemen, let me give you a quick example. You're talking about galvanizing the youth. yesterday I went to Kariokor. I had misplaced my ID, so I went to get a new ID. And those folks over there, by the way, were fantastic. You know, I was fast-tracked in, and I, you know, managed.
Because you had Jeff going out.
No, not that. No. I was nice to people. I was greeting people. But the point is, when I went there, I saw so many young people applying for their IDs for the first time. 18-year-olds, 19-year-olds, 20-year-olds applying for the first time. And you know they are the majority. What do those people need to know between now and 2017 if they are to make a change? Or do we wait another 10 years, another 20 years? What do they need to do?
Jeff, the young people in this country, for the last 10 years, for the last 15 years, have been fighting for change. They have been actually literally the fodder that was used by the opposition leadership in this country to bring about the change. They're the ones who were clobbered. They're the ones who went to prison. They're the ones who died for change in this country. They are still hopeful. What we need to do right now, I want to give you a simple example. There's a party that has come up right now in Delhi. Mm-hmm. You know that?
Yes.
In the capital city.
Yeah.
Which is not Congress and which is not BJP.
Correct.
These are the two major parties that have dominated the politics of India for a very long time. And that man came on an anti-corruption
anniversary.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Anti-corruption. And he appealed to the people. What we need right now is to get people who can come out and tell Kenyans, sorry, these are not the two roads that we need to follow. We have to chart a new way and a new track for Kenyans to be fast-tracked into it, for us to realize our dream. I agree with PLO Lumumba that our country is a great country, but I don't want to get into a situation always of talking of Kenya being the best country in this part of the world.
Absolutely, I agree.
Kenya has got to be one of the best countries in the world. In the world. Mm. We've been talking about this for ages and comparing ourselves with South Korea, with Malaysia, with Singapore, with Hong Kong, which we were doing better off when we got independence.
Yeah.
And today we are comparing ourselves with these countries that have been in a perpetual conflict. Mm-hmm. Uganda has been in a conflict perpetually. Somalia is still a failed state. Ethiopia has been in a military dictatorship under and other civilian dictatorship like what they have now. Mm. I mean, these countries have never seen the kind of history we've had ourselves. We have no reason being around these countries in terms of development. We should be way up there with the Malaysians, with the Koreans, with the Singapores, and all the rest, with Mauritius.
PLO, you always often talk about a man called the Singapore man, Lee Kuan Yew.
Lee Kuan Yew, yes.
Remember, 40 years in power, benevolent dictator. Raise that country standards to world class, if you will. What's it going to take? Because, you know, we've had enough of moaning and groaning and whinging and whining. What's it going to take?
But you see, when your national creed is greed, you can't be a Singapore.
Precisely.
If you look at the professionals in this country, look at the engineers who work with government. They are some of the richest men in this country. How did they become rich? By sheer theft. If you look at some of the civil servants, who are the richest people in this country? How did they become rich? By theft. You look at the politicians, how did they become rich? By theft. They must stop stealing so that we apply our resources to the things that will help our country. How can we be talking about hunger now in Turkana? How can we be talking about lack of resources? We are saying that this country generates sufficient resources to take care of our health, take care of our agriculture, take care of our energy, but we have created a false middle class, which is comprising tenderpreneurs and brokers, and they have distorted the prices of everything in this country, from land to cars and other things. Until we address that, we are not going to realize our potential. And what I urge this administration is to deal with those individuals so firmly that we will be able to create a true middle class, which works for every shilling that they make, so that this country can move in the right direction.
I'm glad you brought up Turkana, because Mheshimiwa, I mean, it just boggles my mind. A few years ago, a good group of Kenyans raised a billion shillings to uplift.
Absolutely.
The other day, they discovered tons or trillions of cubic liters of oil. On top of that, water to last 70 years. What in God's world is going
on? Feeding on dogs.
Thank you.
Feeding on dogs. I have an element that I will celebrate about Turkana now. The current governor, Nanok, was a young man and was with us in parliament. I happen to know some people in the medical fraternity. He has done such a noble job in this very short period of time. He has now an ambulance in every ward. 30 ambulances in every ward. I don't think there's any other county that essentially is being fast-tracked through development in the manner it's being fast-tracked. So I must give a lot of credit and kudos to Narok for what he's trying to do now. But having said that,
yeah.
for people to be starving in our country in this day and age, let me tell you exactly the kind of cycle we have in now. We have a bumper harvest.
Mm-hmm.
The government does not buy that strategic reserve to the extent it should buy.
Mm-hmm.
People come and buy our bumper harvest for a song and send it out of the country. The farmer then decides it's not worth planting maize anymore, the staple food of this country. Then we have a shortage the next time. The moment we have a shortage, we now order for it from outside.
And people now, make money in between.
The brokers,
uh-huh.
the politicians, mm-hmm. the leaders, when I say the leaders, I'm sure you know what I mean.
Yes.
The leaders now cash in on that. So in a sense, the hunger of the North, the starvation of the Turkanas, has been kind of a cash cow for the
indeed.
Leadership of this country.
Yes, indeed.
For a very long time.
But, you know, how do you live with yourself?
We had expected, you know, there's always the philosophical adage that you should have the philosopher king.
Yes.
Or you make your king a philosopher.
Mm.
The entire philosophy of the way our country is run must be changed. We must have a total, a volte-face. We must have 100%, yes. 180 degrees change.
PLO, you agree?
I can't agree more, because if we don't have that fundamental transition, then we are in trouble. Today, Jeff, and you must allow me to say this,
mm-hmm.
one of the most painful things to be in this country is to be honest. That yep. is why yep. every other individual, whether they are lawyers, doctors, engineers, pharmacists, politicians, everybody wants to make the quick buck.
Mm.
Because this country adores only one thing, money. And it doesn't matter how you make it. And once you make enough money, we elect you into parliament. And once we elect you into parliament, having bribed the electorate, then you do what you consider to be right to make money in whichever way you can, and your soul and your conscience is consigned to the museums of history, never to be reawakened, because you want to be rich without more.
And some of these people, their greed and their appetite has become ravenous.
Of course.
They're eating everything inside. They're like locusts. When the locust invades a field, they foggy everything.
Gluttony has now become a national pastime. And if you allow gluttony to be a national pastime, and as I said earlier, greed to be the national creed, then you are in problem.
Moha, he says, Farah Marlin for president, Lumumba for deputy. Pende wasi pende. And then Marcella says, PLO Lumumba for president, and Farah Marlin for running mate. Would you guys ever consider? Would you guys get that vote?
We have nothing to say for the moment. We have only to address the state of the nation for the moment.
Dr. Andrew Sule says PLO forgets that he could be one of those monkeys he's talking about.
Very easily.
But gentlemen, fundamentally, where...
You remember, just to butt in, do you remember this British High Commissioner who was here?
Yes, Edward Clay.
Edward Clay. What did he say?
That we eat until we vomit on our shoes.
Vomit on our shoes. He was talking about the political class. He was talking about the leadership of the country. How we were basically stuffing ourselves. You know, there was an incident sometimes back in the northern Kenya. This poor Kenyan who was, during the famine, the drought, the starvation, had not had a decent meal for about 30 days and suddenly got a good meal.
Mm.
And he fed until he died.
Gluttony.
He
couldn't stop.
He died. He killed him. He ate to death.
Ooh.
Now, if ever there was an eating to death in terms of money for the political class, well, then we would have had so many of them dead and they would be out of the way. You know what I mean?
Yes. Gentlemen, something we haven't talked about, but it's so prevalent. And in fact, today, February 5th, was supposed to be the day the president was supposed to appear for his first day of trial.
Yeah.
Remember?
Yes.
Initially, which was postponed, and then there was a status conference. Let's come back from the break and talk a bit about this ICC and where it's going forward. I mean, it's been the gorilla in the room that everybody knows is there, but few want to discuss.
Indeed.
Let's do that after the break. Keep those tweets coming. At Koinanga Jeff, hashtag JKL. I'm talking to PLO Lumumba. I tell you, he says, when the creed of a nation is greed.
And gluttony.
And gluttony. Yeah. Think about that. Got former Deputy Speaker Farah Marlin. Also, shooting from the hip, taking no prisoners. This is the kind of discussion we want for the kind of Kenya that we want. Jeff Kinangala from the poolside of the Intercontinental continues in a moment. And welcome back to Jeff Koinange live from the poolside of the Intercontinental Hotel. Two great guests and plenty and plenty of tweets coming in thick and fast. I have to read a couple right now. First of all, Sakaja Johnson, it's good to see that you're watching. Hope you spread the word in that big white house where you folks are. Sakaja says, the Jubilee government is all about Kenyans. Farah is being insincere when he says Kenya is worse off now than in 1992. Here's another one. Albert Mandela, he says, sad for a failure like this former deputy speaker to say ODM is dead while he has been a part of the party. One more. Dennis Karamoja says, Malim may have a point, but instead of running away, why can't they stand up and fight for what is deserved? Have you been, you're in the inside.
Yes, yes. Jeff, I'll say this and tell it to Kenyans also. I have looked for an opportunity for us to seriously discuss the future of ODM with our party leader for the last four years. From the first year, from 2008 by 2009, I was asking for us to have at least once every month or 2 months in which certainly the leadership of the party can discuss the future of the party, can point out and bring out things that essentially needs to be done, can work out reforms from inside. Up until 2 weeks ago, I've been calling our party leader and asking him, we need to get together to talk about these things. I have done more than 100 times. Everybody, Peter Anyang Nyong'o, Dalmas Otieno, James Orengo, Raila Odinga, Oburu, Jakoya Midiwa, all of them will tell you, Elmi, this is exactly what Farah has been pushing for the last 4 years. Never got that opportunity. The only time we come together is when there's a fanfare and some kind of a rally, and it's just basically.
Would you take a job with this government if the president called you today and gave you a job, says, Mheshimiwa, do this, come work for me?
Listen, this is not the first time I'm out of parliament. My rule is very simple. Not for all the money in the world would I work for this government or for any other government unless I am happy with the way things are being done. Mm. And I can tell you I'll not take any job in this government. You get my point?
Yeah. PLO, would you?
I had the same thing also in the times when I was out of parliament.
And
I got an offer now, an international offer, after I lost the elections last time. I didn't lose, by the way. Everybody knows what happened.
Nobody ever loses, do they?
Too bad, yes. You're right.
Nobody ever loses.
And history will judge it.
Yeah.
But nonetheless, even then, that was an international job. Mm. I opted not
PLO, would you?
You know, I'm not politically affiliated. Mm-hmm. And if my country requires me to serve, I'll serve this country. Mm.
That's the bottom line.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, good question, good answer. ICC, folks, before we run out of time, ICC has been going on forever, if you will. I mean, throughout, it's plagued the entire last 10 months of this government. Today was supposed to be the president's first day. That's already been postponed. And then there's a status conference to decide whether this case will go on or not. The way things look, this case will be thrown out. The way it looks, it could be back in there, but the way it looks. If it is, the deputy president's case is still going on. Let's face it. There's a lot of friction taking part in this Jubilee coalition between URP and TNA. There's a lot of friction. Some saying one side is favored over the other. Your thoughts, Bielo?
You know, as a lawyer and one who is familiar with the workings of the ICC, there is a possibility that President Kenyatta's case may be thrown out. As I see it, Deputy President Ruto's case is going on. And let us be very realistic. I've looked at the Taylor case. I've looked at the Jean-Pierre Bemba case, the KSU case in Rwanda. The possibilities of a conviction are there, in as much as the possibilities of an acquittal are there. And Shakespeare was right. You reason with the worst. You ask yourself, what if there is a conviction? This country must deal with it. Mm-hmm. And Deputy President Ruto must deal with it. That is how a sober person looks at things. And I'm not one who is going to say and to decide for the case. What I would do if I was Deputy President Ruto's lawyer to tell him, good, we are going to do our best. But as to what the results are, that we leave to the judges.
Absolutely. And you know, something that people don't discuss, Mwashimiwa. Yeah. If he is convicted, if he is found guilty, will that tear this country apart?
If Ruto is found guilty, yes. To begin with, I have my variance in opinion with PLO. Personally, I don't think the deputy president will be found guilty. The threshold for conviction on crimes against humanity, on genocide, is very high. And all that we're hearing so far, there has to be either an audio evidence or a video evidence. And the deputy president's case, it's imagined now, has been a creation of the state. You get my point? Mm. The state as it is at that time, the state machinery worked on it. Because then he was in ODM, and the rest were in PNU. And it looks like also for Uhuru, it must have been a lot with the civil society and people from so-called opposition areas at that time.
Yeah.
And of course, Mungiki, in courts, who had their own issues to pick mm-hmm. up. I'm not in any way saying that one is guilty or not guilty.
Absolutely.
Or absolved
nobody
one or the
that.
Other. Mm-hmm. But the reality of the matter is that I don't think any one of them will be found guilty.
And I would tell Farah.
I've maintained that myself for a very long time.
That as a practicing criminal lawyer, I never tell my client, even in the weakest of cases, I always tell my client, we'll do our very best, but you prepare yourself for
the
any
worst.
Possibility. Mm. You prepare for the worst. And if it happens, how do we deal with it? In other words, if there is a conviction, how do we deal with it? If there is acquittal, we celebrate. And that is how we should look at it. But you've asked a question which is very fundamental.
Mm.
In the event that there is a conviction, God forbid, will this country collapse? No, this country is
not.
Too big.
Absolutely.
To collapse on a conviction of an individual. I think that this country will be saddened. The supporters of Deputy President Ruto will be saddened. The family will be saddened. But this country will find a way of recreating itself, of dealing with that sad event. And it will go on and will continue to pray. But we hope that what is desirable and that justice will be done.
Mm.
This is the most important thing.
In the situation in which, for example, the president, if the president gets convicted and the deputy president is vindicated, or rather he is not proven guilty of anything and is freed, then it's simple. The deputy president becomes the president. That's what the constitution provides.
Correct.
And then he will proceed and appoint his deputy.
Absolutely.
In the unlikely event that does happen, then that's what's going to happen. In equally the unlikely event that the deputy president goes to jail, the president is not going to dissolve the country. The country is not Uhuru and Ruto. The president will have the choice of picking somebody else as his deputy president.
Yeah.
And the country will move on.
We're going to discuss more about the ICC in our JKL tomorrow, Thursday. Be sure to join in, because one of my guests is going to be Ken Wafula, the human rights activist. Love him or hate him, I tell you, he calls it. So please make sure you do that. Giuliani will be next week, as we had advertised before. Make sure Giuliani's on next week. Ledama Olekina, he says, and what did the former U.S. ambassador to Kenya say? We are all swimming in a cesspool of, I can't use that word on TV, corruption. Okay, cesspool of corruption. How do we get rid of this animal? And I know there's corruption worldwide, right?
Let me
tell
you.
It's worldwide. It's everywhere.
It is.
Europe the other day, there's a headline.
Massive
corruption in Europe.
Let me tell you, Jeff, and I am drawing this analogy because history is always recorded. At the time when FDR, Franklin Delano Roosevelt, was the president of the United States of America, there was a problem. You remember there was the Great Depression?
That's right.
And there's a Wall Street collapsed.
Mm-hmm.
And one of those people who were said to have made millions and millions of dollars out of it was the father of the later president, John F. Kennedy.
Joe Kennedy, the bootlegging.
And also from basically buying all these things through insider trading, making a lot of money, and then selling it everything before it collapsed.
Yes.
And when FDR was asked, how can you put such a guy who was so unethical and made so much wealth out of basically those unethical, mm-hmm. you know, the insider trading, the head of that, to streamline Wall Street.
Yeah.
because he initially streamlined Wall Street.
And his answer was?
His answer was, he knows it best. He knows it best.
So you send a thief to catch a thief?
Send a thief to go and catch a thief. And he would he went in there and cleaned up Wall Street. And then later on, there was also a similar scam in the maritime industry. He sent again Joe. And he cleaned it up again. Now, the problems in this country, all these corruptions, all this mess, came about through the KANU days. From the Kenyatta, the Jomo Kenyatta, to Moi time.
Yep.
Both the president and the deputy president happened to be around in one way or the other. More so during the Moi time. They were there. When YK92 was doing all that it was doing, and everybody blames Goldenberg on it, they were there. Mm-hmm. I don't think any one of them is poor today looking for money, in my opinion.
Yeah.
Ideally, these were the princes who should have come now and cleaned up this country.
That's what PLO means when he says the same monkeys.
And I can't agree more. This was if President Kenyatta wants to deal with corruption,
he doesn't need any money.
This is a crusade that he can lead and lead very well, because President Kenyatta does not need money.
He doesn't need money.
What he needs is for historians to remember him well. And he can do it. Besides, and what we need is for him to say, nobody who has engaged in corruption is going to serve in my government.
Besides. And here's the other thing. Bomagi, he says, or Mobagi, he says, sycophancy is reigning supreme. We have to root them out. Sycophancy within the Jubilee as well.
Oh, yes.
It's eating at it.
I don't believe myself, to be very honest to you, I don't believe for one moment Uhuru would want to look for money through corruption. Uhuru has it all. You know, let's be very honest. I'm blatant.
So why does he make an arrest?
The point is, why is he not coming out the same way Kennedy has come out and cleaned up? Why can't you come and clean this country? You see what I mean?
Yeah.
Clean up the place. And clean up.
I can't understand his predicament, because there are too many carryovers. These mandarins, so that there is an oligarchy around him. What he must do is to jettison these, because leadership is like an aircraft. What he must now do is to say that I'm going to have a lean, mean government, and that if you don't toe the line, I'm going to deal with you and deal with your family. We have given him 10 months. I want to believe that come 2 months, in the second year of his term, he must now begin to demonstrate that he's not going to entertain any individual who engages in criminality. And if he does that, then I tell you this country will remember him fondly. But if he doesn't, it will be a very sad day for a generation. It will be said of us that even you who are in the business of shouting, one of your own was given an opportunity to serve and see what he did. So we are urging him, because he's our generation.
And look what your famous words, PLO, that, you know, Kenyans have never missed an opportunity.
To miss an opportunity.
Correct.
Let President Kenyatta not do that, to miss an opportunity.
But what he's doing that a lot of people don't agree, or people in my industry, is this media laws that are coming in and squeezing at us.
Jeff, the buck stops with Uhuru Kenyatta. It doesn't matter whether all of us would want to say that he has no need to do any corruption, he has no need to make more money because he has enough. All those things don't matter. Mm. Even if you have to talk about his own, he is the executive of this country. He personifies the government. He has the majority in parliament. He can do anything he wants today. Anything and bring it on and get the support of Kenyans and get the support of the majority of members of parliament in the House. Even the opposition would be willing to assist him. If he fails to do that, then he takes responsibility for it. Media, as usual, when you're not doing things right, you don't like to be criticized. You get my point?
Yeah.
When you're not doing things right,
yeah.
You don't like to
be criticized. No one likes to be criticized.
Nobody likes to be criticized.
Yeah.
Nobody likes to beam a spotlight on you.
Mm.
Take a torch and beam it on you and say, hey, look at what he's doing.
Yeah.
So media freedom is there to stay. Media freedom is there to stay.
Yeah, you
see, I was saying something. I can't agree with you more, that the media ought to be allowed room to operate. The tragedy is that even now as we are talking, there are mandarins around President Kenyatta who are telling Farah Maalim, PLO Lumumba, John Githongo, Tom Mboya, those are bad people. But we are the good people. The people who come out and tell you what we think
is right.
Without we mean
fear.
Well for you, and we want you to succeed. We are the people that you ought to listen to more often. You ought to read the media that criticizes you more often, because they want you to correct the things that are not right, that you may do it right, that history may remember you right, that you may go down down in history, right, that you may be good. We are the good people.
A good example the other day. A good example, let me tell you.
Yes.
Obama. You know Fox News in America, so anti-Democrat,
yes,
right?
Yes,
anti.
Yes,
I mean,
yes,
they just slam him every single day.
Yes.
The other day, he decided to sit down with O'Reilly, Fox News, and answer his questions.
Yes.
He took the bull by the horns.
Absolutely.
He took it to him.
Precisely.
That's what we need.
Precisely. And the other thing is PLO. Provided we don't ask for a job.
Of course, we are not asking for jobs.
Speaking of job,
we are not asking for
jobs. Francis Kariuki, hey, Chief.
Can you listen to us, I think.
Chief Francis, you know the famous chief who tweets?
Yes.
I think it's been a long time since we heard from Marlin. Yeah. Ali Ndawapi.
Tell him I went back to school. I was in school.
He's a student now.
Chief, I'm a student. Okay.
Agri Muyila. I guess he's answering to Sakaja. He says, I'm yet to feel the goodness of Jubilee government. High wage bill, high unemployment, nja mingi, ufisadi, serikali iko.
Look, the gap between the poor and the rich is leaping. You know, they're leapfrogs. The last 1 year, I'm sure it's even become much more profound. More taxes. More inflation. More expensive basic commodities.
Mm.
School fees, the same thing.
Mm.
The common Kenyan is suffering. The common Kenyan is suffering
absolutely.
In a manner.
Mm. Absolutely.
So basically, there's nothing. They're no goodies. We're talking about laptops. We're talking about all sorts of things.
Uwezo.
And Uwezo. We're talking about double-digit development. Mm. This is not just a top game.
Gentlemen, we have exactly 2 minutes. PLO, I'm going to let you have the last word. We've got a minute each. Go.
Jeff. I've always held the view that this country can't be great, but it will only be great if our men and women in positions of leadership do that which is good and right. The people are prepared to support them, but they must listen to the people and ensure that the quality of the people's lives are improved economically, politically, and socially. But if they don't, the people will speak out, and if the people speak out and they don't listen, the people will rise up. That is the lesson of history.
Absolutely. Mheshimiwa.
The signs are not good. Kenyans, you see, the tree of liberty, they say. Right now, it's not just liberty we're seeking because of the issues on the media and the rest of it. We're seeking the basic necessities, which are guaranteed in our constitution. Kenyans are starving. Those basic necessities, Kenyans need to fight for those things. Kenyans need to come out from the cocoons that they were very conveniently placed by the leadership of this country. The people who are eating, the people who are doing all these corrupt deals are just a couple of hundred of them. Maybe 200, 300, more than that.
Make some arrests.
But every other Kenyan is suffering in the same manner. A Kalenjin Kenyan is suffering, a Kikuyu ordinary Kenyan is suffering the same way a Luo, a Somali, a Luya, a Kisi, and everybody else is suffering. So Kenyans need to rise up now and demand from their government what they ought to get from their government. The government has to be responsive to the needs of Kenyans. Too much on the TV and giving us all this lip service, you know, talk big, talk big.
Mm.
And they're in the government.
And they're the government.
Before you could see them sitting out there and saying the Sarakasi of Peter Mchezo and Peter, fine, that was electioneering period. Today you are in power. Make the difference.
Yeah, and PLO, it was JFK who said, ask not what your country can do for you.
That's what you can do for your
and
country.
Jeff exactly. was right.
Emmanuel Kimutai wants the last word from you, PLO. He says, one last Kiswahili parting shot by PLO.
Kiswahili, Mwalimu Nyerere akasema thamani ya taifa ni kuwa na vijana wenye malezi bora, siha njema na bongo kali.
Hapo. Yeah.
Siha njema, siha ni afya.
Yeah, hiyo.
Kweli. At least I know that bit because it's an Arabic word also in addition to it.
Gentlemen,
thank you.
Great to see you.
Thank you very
great
much.
Great conversation.
Thank you very
Let's
much.
Keep this going.
Yeah.
Keep saying if the day we stop talking,
one last
the day we start fighting.
One last thing.
We've got to go to the news.
Yeah.
Got to go to the news. They're calling me. They're screaming in my ear. We'll keep talking.
Cancel the contract.
Cancel the tender.
Cancel the tender with the Chinese. Make it above board. Let's go back to the sticks.
All right. Well, you heard it from former Deputy Speaker Farah Marlin, former Member of Parliament for Lagdera. Also, former anti-corruption czar PLO Lumumba. I hope you had a pen and paper, dictionary, thesaurus, Wikipedia, because this man, English, Swahili, you name it, he waxes lyrical. It's the kind of conversation we need for the kind of Kenya we want. Tomorrow, we are all about the ICC once again. And among the guests, human rights activist Ken Wafula. He's driving all the way from Kitale tonight, and he's coming in guns blazing. Join us then. In the meantime, the news continues with Nancy Kachungira and Ben Kitili. Thanks so much for watching JKL. Please continue tweeting at Kwenanga Jeff. good night and good luck.